Karate Kid Part 1. Interestingly enough, and believe it or not, as big as a fan as I was of these movies, I always knew that Bill Conti did the music, who also did the music in Rocky. I had no idea up until just recently that John Avildsen actually directed the films as well, the guy that did the original Rocky. So that was sort of odd, I thought, but it definitely makes sense, because the interesting thing about the similarities, not a whole lot of similarities between Rocky and Karate Kid, but the musical cues, the music placement is almost identical in certain scenes. You know, the one that everyone always talks about is the, you know, when Miyagi is, puts his hands together and then the, you know, the dramatic Bill Conti music hits in. So, and oddly enough, I'm a huge fan of the Rocky movies as well. So, there's, you know, more to it than just that. But,
guy is definitely the Orson Welles of inspirational sports style movies. I'll say that.
Yeah.
Okay. So, I mean, it seems kind of strange to have to explain the plot to this movie, but, I guess we might as well explain it. I'm sure almost everybody has seen this movie. If you grew up in the 80s, you have to have seen this movie. There's no way. But The Karate Kid is the story of young Danielson, played by Ralph Macchio, who moves to the San Fernando Valley and moves away from the East Coast. And upon, like, coming to this new school, he starts this relationship with, what's the girl's name in it?
Allie,
who's played by Elizabeth Shue. And in doing that, kind of upsets Johnny, who is William Zabka in this film, who's like his arch nemesis throughout the film because that's like the girl that he wants to be with and all this stuff. So he's a part of a dojo, martial arts dojo called the Cobra Kai, and he starts whipping Daniel's ass on a daily basis.
And his little henchmen.
Yeah, and his group of other henchmen, they start whipping up on him. So Danielson has no choice but to try to figure out karate, but he doesn't have anybody to teach him. And he just happens to stumble upon this landlord, or not landlord. It's like a handyman, played by, of course, Pat Morita, who was, I guess up to that point, best known from Happy Days as like Arnold, the stand-up comedian guy or whatever. And so he finally, after like begging him, after Daniel begs him forever, Mr. Miyagi takes him under his wing and teaches him this brand of martial arts that's kind of like, it's almost monk-like in the fact that he doesn't really know that he's being taught anything until after the lessons are over. Like, it's the wax on, wax off stuff. I remember, was it in the second film? It was the paint the house stuff that he had him do, all of it which serves like a purpose to defend yourself against attacks and all this stuff. So this all leads up to this huge showdown at the karate tournament. The All Valley Karate Tournament at the end of the film, where it's the Cobra Kai Dojo versus basically just him versus Daniel, and with probably one of the most memorable endings to a film ever. So that's the Karate Kid in a nutshell there.
Yeah, and like I was saying, I mean, the music, and there's music not only from Bill Conti, but just like, I guess, pop music at the time, strategically placed. I think it's one of those movies, too, that really relies a lot on the score as well. Like throughout the entire movie, especially the, you know, the fight sequences and stuff. You got the classic songs, you know, The Best Around, Then you got the Banana Rama, which is the Cruel Summer song, which we've used a lot on the show. And
it's a cruel, cruel, cruel summer, leaving me here on my own. It's a cruel, cruel, cruel summer.
Yeah.
Now you're gone.
That one.
But like, it's a great movie all the way around, though. Like, it's the performances. I think the true star of the movie was Pat Morita, just because, like, because I never watched Happy Days, you know, when I was growing up or anything. I didn't know what that was. You would never think that this guy speaks perfect English.
No,
that. Yeah, I mean, he's just mumbling throughout the entire movie. Doesn't really speak broken English, stuff like that. Does an excellent job. Like, I don't know where he got that voice from.
It's kind of weird when you actually watch the special features and you see the way that he talks and how he's able to just switch into that voice. And that, not even just that he changes his voice, he changes the whole way that he speaks. Like, the cadence to the way that he speaks and stuff has changed completely, which is... it's just bizarre and kind of like surreal to watch him do that.
Yeah. I think the other big star in the movie as well is Martin Cove, who is Sensei Kreese, and just plays like an awesome, like, just evil motherfucker. You know, so evil, in fact, that he does things in the movie, tells his students to do things. His students, who are the bad guys as well, look at him and like, wow, he's a mean son of a bitch, you know?
Yeah. Isn't this like, wouldn't you say, though, this was probably one of the first movies where they had like a montage that was really noticeable?
One of the first ones I remember.
Yeah, it was like really noticeable montage with, I guess maybe Rocky was the first one like that had like, but this is the one that I remember even more than Rocky because of the music and all the stuff.
Well, I always remember, too, that Lamar from Revenge of the Nerds is a
guy. I'd forgotten about that until I started watching it, too, but yeah. And, I mean, this movie has so many, like, classic quotes and so many classic characters and so many, like, I mean, it would take forever to go through all of them. And if I'm not mistaken, I could be wrong, but I don't think I am. Isn't Larry Drake in this fucking movie? He's the guy that's like giving them shit out there when he's drinking beer and putting it on their car and stuff.
Yeah, and that's when Miyagi does the the chop off of the top of the beer bottles and all that. Actually, though, too, like, I don't know if you remember this. There was a music video came out probably about 3 or 4 years ago.
Sweep the Leg.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Big internet hit, got all these guys back, you know, aside from Pat Morita, who'd passed on, almost everybody, like even the Cobra Kai henchmen guys were back, which is hilarious. You know, the guy that says, get him a body bag or whatever, he's going to need a body bag. He was back and he looks fucking hilarious. But the interesting thing is, and I was like, what the fuck is this guy doing? William Zabka is almost exactly the way he looked like 25 years earlier. Because in the music video, they have the exact same costumes and stuff on in certain parts of the movie. And you could cut back because he is like, I know he's into martial arts and stuff for real. So he's probably keeping himself in good shape and stuff. But yeah, I mean, he looks almost identical the way he looked in the movie when he was like 23, 24 years old. But that's an awesome music video, though, if you haven't seen it.
Yeah, it really is.
I was hoping they would have it on this, on the Blu-ray. That would have been killer, because it is almost like a sequel to the first movie, but the whole story of the music video is Johnny actually wins the match.
Yeah, I can't remember who even did it. It was like some punk band or something that never really had another hit, I don't think.
I can't recall the name of the band. The band wasn't that good, but, you know.
Yeah, the idea for the music video was great, though. But... I think that the thing that makes this movie so classic and so iconic is the character of Mr. Miyagi, for one. Like, that's the major thing. But also the story behind it, which is, you know, a David versus Goliath kind of story with a really, really awesomely choreographed ending, which there's a guy that I know taught a lot of these people. I can't remember his name right off the hand. He was a martial arts instructor.
I know the referee with the mustache.
Yeah, that's him. Yeah. I can't remember his name. I think it's Pat something, but I couldn't be sure. Anyway, like, he was responsible for training everybody on the film, and like
Pat Hall.
The way that he choreographed it was, and I guess because they spent so much time working on it, it looks like a lot better than, even like Rocky. Because in Rocky, you can clearly tell that a lot of the fight sequences are choreographed. But in this, it's harder to tell. I'm guessing because of the camera angles and because he had some experience filming stuff. The director has some experience filming stuff like that now, so.
Well, I mean, that's hard. I'm sure that's really hard to film as well, too, because a lot of the, you got to be real tight with a lot of the punches and all that.
And yeah, I mean, and of course, like Ralph Macchio was talking about, he did get kicked in the head and stuff like a couple of times, and I think they used a cut of him getting kicked in the head for the scene where they're all in the skeleton costumes and they rough him up and all that stuff. So yeah, so I mean, if you're coming that close, you're eventually going to get tagged like he did.
Shit fucked.
Yeah,
but it's an excellent movie. It's one of those movies that I always see myself rewatching, probably once or twice a year. And the Blu-ray, we did get to see the Blu-ray. That's what we were reviewing of it. And, you know, the Blu-ray, as far as the detail goes, it's not like extremely over-detailed, you know. I mean, you can tell it's in high def. I think that it's definitely more colorful, though, than I noticed the colors really seem to pop off the screen a lot more than the standard def one did.
Yeah, it's, I mean, it's okay transfer. The film looked well enough. I mean, there was some, like, grain in certain scenes of it that I thought was very similar to the DVD, but overall you can tell, and especially the more lit, the well-lit scenes, that it's good. Well, this film takes place, either, it seems like, on the beach or in the dark. Like, there's not a real contrast, so, like, you can really tell when things change, like, because you got a bunch of night scenes, including the scenes where, like, he gets roughed up and the scenes where they go to the arcade thing, which I always thought when I was a kid and saw this movie, like, that would have been the most awesome shit ever to have something like that around. You know, where it's like the miniature golf course meets the, like, the arcade and the racing car, like, the racetrack and all that stuff's all together. We never had anything like that around here.
A lot of the water slides and stuff there, too.
Yeah. So,
which all this stuff was real, too. That was like a real location. I don't know if that's still there, but I do know that the building where Daniel lived, that's almost identical. That almost looks exactly the same as it did. And I know there's videos on YouTube where people actually went there and to various other places that were used in the movie around that area.
Yeah, I mean, to show you how amazing this movie is, the guy that trained everybody on this film also had been in movies like Enter the Dragon and movies with Chuck Norris and movies with Jackie Chan. And he said in the featurettes that this was his favorite movie that he ever had anything to do with. So, I mean, the guy's worked with legends, but this movie is like...
Yeah. I mean, it's not, that's the thing. It's not just a great, like, movie for martial arts people, you know, to see good fight sequences and stuff like that. It's also just a good fucking movie, you know. And if there's somebody out there that hasn't seen it, I would highly recommend checking it out.
I'll tell you something that I did notice on here that was really, really... well, it was a lot better than I thought it would be. They've got this feature on the Blu-ray called Blue Pop, which is... it's like a pop-up video thing where, like, during the course of a movie, the actors will come up and tell you stuff about how they film certain scenes, which... The Infinifilm tried to do something like that, but it was, like, really, really annoying, and it just, like, popped up and had, like, you had to switch back and stop the film, and, like, it would take you to the featurette section, basically, where they talked about whatever you were... This is just, like, the people actually pop up while you're watching the film and, like, tell you, like, about the scene. So it doesn't interfere with the flow of the movie or anything.
Yeah, it's just the Blu-ray technology of goodness.
And it's also got the commentary with director John Alson, writer Robert Mark Kamen, who is the guy that, he was actually the one that had the martial arts experience, and he, I think he was a black belt and wrote the film about his experiences in different ways.
And basically, all the stuff that was on the DVD edition that came out, I'm thinking aside from the pop-up.
Yeah, and Ralph Macchio and Pat Morita, Way of the Karate Kid multi-part featurette, Beyond the Forum featurette, East Meets West, and Life of Bonsai featurette, which is exactly what it sounds like. It's like a guy that tells you, like, he's had all this experience trimming bonsai trees and stuff.
Yeah. The weird thing is, I think not long after the DVD edition came out, they did all those special features. Pat Morita died. Like within
I knew he died
4 or 5 months, you know, after or something like that. But the movie's a classic. It's going to be one of those movies that lives on and on for years, decades to come, stuff like that. And I would actually highly recommend everyone going out and checking out the first Karate Kid for sure.
A special thank you goes out to our supporters on Patreon. The Patreon website has a complete archive of the Dead Pit Radio shows starting way back in 2005, in addition to all of the midweek shows, archived commentaries, all that good stuff. If you're interested, and we appreciate all the support, go to www.patreon.com/intothedeadpit. Tiers start as low as $1 per month.